worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was Sublessed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior. How is a bhikkhu moderating eating? While reflecting rationally, he eats food neither for the sake of entertainment, nor of infatuation, nor wishing for bodily beauty, but exclusively for the support and maintenance of this body, for ending discomfort, and for assisting this noble life, considering, thus will I now end this old feeling of hunger, yet without arousing any new feeling of greed. Thus will I remain healthy, blameless, and in comfort, exactly as one treats an open wound, only for the purpose of healing it, or as one greases an axle only for the sake of easy transport of a heavy load. So does a bhikkhu who is moderated in eating while always reflecting rationally eat food. Thank you. Hello to you, friends, and yet another walk and guided meditation talk on core Buddhist concepts while in the forest. This time it's about the six mental perfection, kanti parami, the mental perfection of patience, tolerance, endurance. It comes from the word kamati, to be patient, to endure, to forgive, to show forbearance. Actually, one should think that this is different qualities, but it's the same quality whether it's physical endurance, running a marathon, or whether holding back one's anger while scolded, or when not choosing to punish a wrongdoer. It's the ability to endure patiently without reacting emotionally any kind of unpleasant, painful feeling, whether it's a mental unpleasant feeling in the form of frustration, disappointment, anger, irritation, or it's a physical painful feeling, could be hunger, can be pain in the legs or knees while meditating or running. So physical endurance and mental endurance come down to the same mental quality, the ability to endure pain, whether mental or physical. This is basically patience, kanti parami, which the Buddha notably called the highest praxis you can do. The highest training is this lifelong training in patience. Actually, it is first fully perfected for the arahant being. So it's not something that wants to underestimate. It can be practiced everywhere when dealing with the spouse, children, boss, friends, in the train, typical situations in the supermarket queue while waiting for the desk clerk to finish the former customer, in the bank queue, while dealing with public organizations which takes a very long time, and similar situations. Patience, endurance, tolerance. So one can tolerate this painful feeling arising from things one wants to happen that doesn't happen, or things one doesn't want to happen that actually happens. So is this kanti, this patience, forbearance, tolerance, forgiveness, is one of the 10 perfections, the 10 parami, and this is number 6, the 6th mental perfection. And the characteristic of this patience is acceptance, that one can accept whatever one dislikes. Its function is to endure, and its manifestation is non-opposing tolerance. One doesn't go against the beings or situations or the phenomena that one dislikes, just because one dislikes them. One looks on with even equanimity, upekkha, and does not react emotionally. The cause of patience is understanding. one understands why the situation one doesn't want to happen, that actually happens. Or why the other beings, they react as they react. One understands that. One understands their situation. One understands this situation and why physical phenomena, they happen. So this understanding makes one say, ah, but how can it be different? How can it be different? Then one can tolerate and endure it easily. One can understand how things really are, how things really develop, how things and phenomena and beings really become, not only now, but also later. Then there will not be this disappointment, because when it's very realistic, there will be no expectation. Because of no expectation, no frustration, no disappointment, and thereby a very enduring, patient tolerance for whatever situation may come. The effect of patience is a calm tranquility despite presence of intense stirring provocation. Calm tranquility despite presence of intense stirring provocation. Patience of the will produces forgiving forbearance. So patience on the intention say, ah, okay, now there's some wrongdoing or some, I think there's some wrongdoing, but I can forgive the wrongdoers anyway. It doesn't help if I become angry. Patience of the intellect produce faith, confidence, and certainty. Why so? Patience of the intellect, yes, because then one examines, scrutinizes, drill into things further. If one does that, then eventually one will come to Buddhist faith. Then confidence in training, and when after having experienced the states themselves, certainty. Patience of the body produces resolute strength and tenacious endurance. I ran marathon twice when I was young, and this takes a lot of endurance, a lot of pain. You have to eat a lot of pain, spoon after spoon, of intense pain in the legs and in the whole body actually, both while running and especially in the 2 or 3 days after the run. Then it's really, really difficult because you cannot come out of bed, you cannot go up upstairs. So there you have to be patient and say, okay, I did this and that, now I have to endure the pain. External tolerance of other beings is forbearance and forgiveness. One should know that any pointing the finger, any blaming, and say you did this and that wrong, one should see that upstream in samsara, one does the very same wrong, perform the very same wrong action, billions of billions of billions of times. So this blaming finger is always hypocrisy, because how can one blame some mistakes that one have done oneself a million times or more, a million, million times? Of course this is hypocrisy. Huh? There is a wrong, yes, one should point out the wrong, but one shouldn't blame. Shouldn't blame. Know that the blaming finger has three fingers pointing back on oneself and one finger pointing upwards. So if one can reel back with patience this finger, then suddenly we have another situation. Huh? We go up. Huh? But this one is like a gun, smoking gun. Get that finger in. Look at the mirror. Ah. Then it's another situation. Then forbearance and forgiveness is easy. Or at least less difficult. He who patiently protects himself protects also all other beings. He protects himself from greed, anger, and ignorance. So he protects other beings also. He who patiently protects all other beings protects himself also. Because if he doesn't protect other beings, then eventually he will harm them. And because of the karmic mirror, this harm will come back to himself. So protecting others is protecting yourself. Protecting yourself is protecting others. Same thing. Very skillful. Not easy, but possible. Not from speaking much is one called clever. The patient one, free from anger, free from fear. Such steady, persisting one is rightly called clever. Dhammapada 258. Patient tolerance is the highest praxis. Nibbana is the supreme bliss. So say all the Buddhas. Dhammapada 184. The innocent one who has done nothing wrong, yet who endures abuse, flogging and even imprisonment, such one armed with stamina. This great force of tolerance, such stoic one, who self-possessed can accept all. Such one I call a holy one. Dhammapada 399. One should follow those who are determined, tolerant and enduring, intelligent, wise, diligent, clever, good-willed, and evidently noble. One shall stick to them as the moon remains in its regular orbit. Dhammapada 208. Again, praising again and again of those who have these qualities of patience, endurance, forgiveness, forbearance, tolerance. It is not without a reason a mental perfection. It's because of lack of this we overreact and punish ourselves, the world and others. Friends, the Buddha said, even if bandits were to cut you up savagely, limb by limb, with a two-handled saw, you should not get angry, but do my bidding. Remain pervading them all with a friendly awareness imbued with an all-embracing goodwill. Kind, rich, expansive, and immeasurable. Free from hostility, free from any ill will. Always remembering this very simile of the saw, so indeed should you train yourself. Majjhima Nikaya, number 21. Very famous simile of the saw. If some robbers come and cut you up, cut limb after limb off you, then you should not be angry with them. A difficult task. But just remember that. If you should not be angry with those, because it doesn't make sense, it doesn't become better. Actually, if you are very friendly with them, then they might stop torturing you. But if you become angry with them, then they chop off the head also. So it's rational not to oppose, not to become angry, but to tolerate. So if you should tolerate that, how much more should you tolerate whatever other persons do that do less than cutting your arms and legs off one by one with a two-handled saw? How much more should you be tolerant with those of whatever irritation they provoke you with? It's less than cutting your legs off with a two-handled saw. The five way of removing irritating annoyance. Bhikkhus, the Buddha said, there are these five ways of removing annoyance by which any irritation can be entirely removed by a bhikkhu when it arises in him. What are the five ways? One, friendliness, metta, can be maintained towards the irritating person or situation. Friendliness, one. Two, understanding can be undertaken towards the irritating person or state. Understanding. The course of patience, understanding. Three, unlooking equanimity, upekka, can be kept towards an irritating person or phenomena. Four, one can forget and ignore the irritating person, mental or physical state. Friendliness, understanding, equanimity, and forget it. Five, ownership of karma of the irritating person can be reflected upon thus. This good and worthy person is owner of his or her actions, inherit their results, and is indeed born of these actions. And only he or she is responsible for their actions, be they good or bad. This is how annoyance with the irksome, the irritating, can be instantly removed. These are the five ways of removing annoyance and by which any irritation can be entirely removed by any wise friend, exactly when it arises. Anguttara Nikaya, Book of Fives, 5, number 161. So, the prerequisite here is awareness. Mind sees mind become irritated. Irritation starts to grow up. Then it remembers this sutta. Friendliness, understanding, equanimity, forget it, and karma. Friendly towards a person, understanding why they are in this situation, why they are angry or opposing or irritating, unlooking equanimity, forget it, simply ignore it, think about something else, and karma, the work of karma. All beings are owners of the karma. Those out there and this in here. Whatever happens, whatever is done, whatever is performed, whatever reaction, fair or unfair, the owners will always come back to the actor. The results will always be mirrored back, karmically speaking, to the actor. Another famous sutta, Buddha to his son, Rahula, said this. Rahula, develop an imperturbable mind, like the elements. Rahula, develop a mind like earth. Then contacts of arising like and dislike will not obsess your mind. Rahula, on the earth is dumped both pure and impure. Excrement, urine, spit, pus, snot, blood, but the earth does not detest any of that. Even and exactly so, make your mind stable like the earth. Rahula, develop a mind like water. Then contacts of arising pleasure and pain will not seize your mind, will not grab your mind. Rahula, with water, both the pure and the impure are cleaned. Washed away with water are excrement, urine, snot, pus, spit, and blood. Yet the water does not despise any of that. Even so, make the mind fluid and adaptable like the water. Rahula, develop a mind like fire. Develop a mind like fire. Then the contacts of arising, attraction, and aversion will neither consume nor hang on, cling to your mind. Rahula, fire burns both the pure and the impure, burns excrement, urine, spit, saliva, snot, pus, and blood. Yet the fire does not loathe, disgust any of that. In the same manner, make your mind like a tool, like an all-consuming and purifying fire. Make your mind like a purifying and all-consuming fire. Rahula, develop a mind similar to space. Then contacts of arising delight and frustration does neither take hold of nor remain in your mind. Space does not settle anywhere. Similar, make the mind unsettled, doesn't land anywhere, and unestablished, like open space. When you expand mind like space, contacts of delight and frustration will neither be able to dominate nor ever obsess your mind. Majjhima Nikaya, the middle-length discourses of the Buddha, number 62. Patience is the highest praxis. In the Jataka stories, the Buddha, he told about his former life stories. There's 547 of them. Then number 313 is Kantivada, Jataka, birth story. And there he was a boy called Kondaka. There was a very rich family in Kasi, and he inherited their immense richness. And after that, he thought to himself, my parents, they came in and then they went away with this richness. It didn't give them anything. So I will also give it away. And then he carefully selected those out in Kasi that were worthy of getting it, namely those who have given alms, those who have given themselves. They got what he had of immense richness, and then he went into Himalaya. Then he lives there on roots and berries, and then he came back to Benares to get salt and vinegar. And there he walked around, and then the king's commander saw him and invited him to stay in the king's park, and so he did. Then one day the king came there, he was called Kalabu, king of Benares, and he came there with his harem, and he has drunk alcohol. And he came into the park and all the dancing girls had danced, and then he picked out his favorite from the harem, and then he fell asleep with the head in her lap. Then the dancing girls said to themselves, for whom we are dancing and playing music is asleep, now we can go around and look. And then they found the Bodhisattva, which was the Buddha, was sitting under a tree, and then they asked him, tell us something worth hearing. And so he spoke to them intensely and at length with the kama. Then the girl in whose lap the king was sleeping, she moved a little bit about, and then the king waked up and said, where's the girls? Where's these rich girls? And then she explained, they have gone and listened to this ascetic that is sitting under the tree. And then because he was drunk, he grabbed his sword and also jealous, wants to kill the Bodhisattva. But the girls then quickly, some of the best looking ones, they got up and calmed him down and got his sword. Then he called his king commander, his executioner, who came with swords and a whip and some knives. And then he said, what's your pleasure, sir? We will test this false ascetic, this sham recluse. Which speaks about patience. He has spoken about patience like I did today to these dancing girls and musicians, female musicians of the king. And then he said, whip him with your whip and these thorns. He had also kind of like a special whip of thorns. And he whipped him and he gave him 1,000 blows. Then he was, of course, the Bodhisattva, Gautama Bodhisattva, he was completely bleeding all over and he was flogged on his back. And then he said, so now, what about your patience? Dear sire, the Bodhisattva said, patience doesn't sit in the skin. It sits in the heart and in the mind. So you cannot see it. Said this drunken king. Chop off his legs and his arms. Then we ask him again about this patience. Then this executioner, he chopped off both his feet and his hands. And then he put him on the block again, this execution block. And then he asked, what about patience now? Endurance now? Dear sire, the Bodhisattva asked, patience does not sit in the hands and in the feet. It sits in the mind and in the heart. And this, of course, made this king even more enraged. So he said, cut off his nose and his ears. And they cut off his nose and ears. Now he was bleeding profusely because four arteries has been cut, nose and ears cut. So he again asked, what about your... sire, patience does not sit in the ears or in the nose. They sit in the mind and in the heart. And then this angry king, which was Devadatta, the former later become Devadatta, he kicked him in the chest, so he tumbled about, now without hands, feet, and nose, and ears. And there he lay bleeding. Then the commander chief, which was Sariputta at that time, he came and asked for forgiveness, that he should not judge all of them. It was only the king that was evil. And he then cleaned his wounds and bandaged him. But nevertheless, the Bodhisattva then said, long live the king. I hereby forgive them. And so this is an example of this extreme ability to forbearance. In this case, unfortunately, resulting in his own death, because he died the very same day. And then all the dancing girls and the musicians and all on the castle, they came and gave obeisance to his corpse, including the commander in chief, which has invited him in there. So Kalabu, the king, the drunken king, was Devadatta, and the commander-in-chief was Sariputta. And the story was told when a monk in the Buddhist dispensation became angry and wrathful. Then he told this story, "I'm a monk, don't become angry, because you have entered this Buddhist dispensation, this Buddhist sasana. You have become a Buddhist disciple who preach about non-anger, forbearance, tolerance, patience, and endurance." And then he told this Kantivara Jataka story, number 313. So this Jataka is frequently mentioned as an example of supreme forgiveness. The Jataka further illustrates how a man's anger can grow towards an unoffending victim, and how an angry man later on loses all his prosperity, because this evil karma of course came back to Devadatta himself, still screaming and burning in hell. By this exposition of the sixth mental perfection, which you can learn more about by going to whatbuddhasaid.net and search for patience, I will end this small, nice forest Dhamma Desana, Dhamma teaching, by the usual exit. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, indeed, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, indeed. Thank you, and may you have a nice, patient, tolerant, enduring, forgiving, and forbearant day. Thank you. I'd just like to add one thing about this patience and endurance I came to think about after having closed the camera. So patience and endurance also comes in when you're doing something, doing your work or baking a cake or making a video like this, editing the video, whatever professional thing you do, whatever task at hand there is. Then whether you reach 20 degrees of completement or 50 degrees or 98 degrees or 82 degrees of perfection, whether you complete the task and make it perfect, that also depends upon this endurance, patience, tolerance, that you can forgive the situation, that the thing doesn't develop like you think it should be, not as quickly as your impatient mind likes it to be, but you hang on there with the task and keep polishing the mirror until it becomes completely perfect. That's also patience, kandi, parami, the mental perfection of patience, tolerance, endurance, forgiveness, and forbearance. Thank you, and have a nice day.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.